Oh, When praises go up, blessings come down. Did anybody come to bless his name on this morning? Did anybody come to bless the Lord's name? You know, I don't know about you, but all I want to do is give him praise. Anybody want to give him praise on this morning? All I want to do. Thank you. Exodus chapter 33.
text, we will be looking at 18 through 23, but I want to start reading verse 14, if you don't mind reading for our hearing, because the Bible said faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So I'm reading from the Amplified translation, and it says in verse 14, "And the Lord said, my presence shall go with you." Amen, somebody.
Amen.
"And I will give you rest." That word rest really means I'm going to go with you and I'm going to give you peace. I wish I had somebody this morning.
Amen.
Anybody need some peace this morning?
Amen.
And verse 15 it says, "And Moses said to the Lord, if your presence does not go with me, do not carry us up from here." In other words, if you ain't going, then I don't want to go. I wish I had somebody this morning. Verse 16, he said, "For by what shall it be known that I and your people have found favor in your sight? Is it not in your going with us so that we are distinguished, I and your people, from all the other people upon the first of the face of the earth?" In other words, he's saying, it's something about God that makes us different. When you got God in your life, there's a difference. Wish I had church this morning. So he says, in verse 17, he says, "And the Lord said to Moses, I will do this thing also that you ask. For you have found favor, loving kindness, and mercy in my sight." And get this, "and I know you personally and by name." Amen. Don't, ain't you glad this morning? I know proper English, but ain't you glad that God know you personally this morning?
Yeah.
That he touched you on your shoulder
this
morning and allowed you to see this day.
Yeah.
Verse 18, "And Moses said, I beseech you, show me your glory." Hey, God. Verse 19, "And God said, I will make all my goodness pass before you. And I will proclaim my name, the Lord, before you. And for I will be gracious to whom I'll be gracious. And I will show mercy and love and kindness on whom I will show mercy and love and kindness." And verse 20 says, "But he said, you cannot see my face, for no man can see me and live." And in verse 21 he says, "And the Lord said, behold, there's a place beside me." Oh God.
Yes,
"and you shall stand upon a rock." Verse 22 says, "And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cliff of the rock and cover you with my hand until I pass by. And then I will take away my hand and you will see my back, but my face shall not be seen." I wish for a moment I just want to talk to you from this topic this morning. I want to talk about the glory of God. Amen. Somebody say the glory of God.
Glory of God.
Father, we thank you this morning. We bless you. We honor you, God, and we give you praise in this place. God, we give you glory. Father, we realize today there's nothing that we can do without you. We can do all things through Christ which strengthens us. God, we thank you for loving us in spite of us. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you've allowed us to see another day. God, you brought us back to the house of worship once again. And we pray today, God, that there's something said by the Spirit of God that will uplift us. Let us know, God, that this journey, everything will be all right. Maybe some ups and downs, but God, as long as you are by our side, everything will be all right. We pray it all in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Look at your neighbor and tell them, there's something about the glory of God. Amen. This morning, by way of introduction to the text, for many of you during this pandemic, you have gone through a season of waiting. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You've gone through a season of waiting. You've been waiting on God to bring you out of what you're in. Some people have been waiting on God's healing. Some people have been waiting on God's deliverance. Some people have been waiting on God to bring them out of their financial struggles. Some people have been waiting for God to manifest himself in their relationship. But this morning I came to tell you that we are going through this season of waiting, but you're not waiting by yourself. I came to tell you this morning that God gave us a promise that he would never leave us, nor would he forsake us. And so even though I've got to go through this season of waiting, even though I've got to go through this season of heartache and pain, even though I've got to go through what I'm going through, I'm encouraged this morning because I know I ain't got to go through it by myself.
That's right. Amen.
So you've gone through a season of waiting, a season, get this, of preparing, because there's a transformation period that we all must go through, where you have to leave behind one state to enter another. In other words, when you look at the text, they are trying to, they've been traveling ever since Egypt, and they have made their way to Deacon Mary right here at the mountain of Mount Sinai. And here it is, they've been promised the promised land, but they're in a season of waiting. Why they're in a season of waiting? They're in a season of waiting because they have angered God. They have upset God. And I just came to tell somebody this morning that sometimes when God has you stagnant, you got to find out why I'm in the same place that I am. It's because maybe I'm not doing what God has called me to do. Maybe I have not repented of my sin. But you got to find out why I'm stuck in this state. Hey. So you have to leave one state to enter another. And for some of you, this is why it feels like a part of you is coming to an end, because it's a reconstruction of the inner world. In other words, God is doing something on the inside of you. And when God is doing something on the inside of you, you can feel the reconstruction. You can feel the revival. You can feel the restoration. Can I just tell you something the Bible said in Philippians 1 and 6? He said, we have this confidence that he that had begun a very work in you will continue until the day of Jesus Christ. Is there anybody in the building today that's glad that God is still working on the inside of me? Because God is working in us. Get this. You're shedding so many layers of what was to be renewed, to be revived, and to be regenerated. And for so many of you, you're struggling because you're ready to grow, but you're not willing to let go. I better say it again. So many of us are struggling to grow because we're still trying to hold on to yesterday. We're still trying to hold on to last week. We're still trying to hold on to last year. Many of us are still trying to hold on to past relationships. We're still trying to hold on to what I once was instead of becoming what God wants you to be. And when you are struggling to evolve into what God is calling you to be, you will always struggle. You'll always struggle. Hey, because I've discovered in my life that everything you're going through is preparing you for what you've been asking God for. I'm going to say that again. Everything you're going through is preparing you for what you've been asking God for. And the reason you feel unsettled is because you know you're meant for more. Baby, I wonder this morning, there's anybody this morning that would say, I'm not comfortable where I'm at because I know God has so much more for me. I'm not going to stand on the bank when my blessing is out there in the deep. I'm willing to step out on faith because I discovered in his word where he said we walk by faith and not by sight. God knows
somebody. God knows the when, the where, and the why, and the how. So all we have to do is make sure that we're open to the plan of God for our life. Moses was open to the plan of God because Moses realized that God had not placed them at this mountain to stay, but God was calling them to the promised land. But the problem was, while Moses was up visiting with God one day, the people had made an idol calf that they were worshiping. And Moses, out of anger, throws down the tablet and busts up the very thing that God had given him. Can I pause right here? Can I tell you something? You never throw down what God has gave you based on what somebody else is doing. You better hold on to your faith and don't let go. You don't let what people have been doing, what people have been saying, for you to lose your walk with God. You don't throw down the work that God has placed in your hand because a few knuckleheads don't know how to act. But you got to hold on. God's unchanging. Changing hands. So Moses began to ask God, because God says, if I go with them, I've got to destroy them, Sister Williams. And Moses began to tell him, well, if you destroy them, the people will say that you brought them out for an evil reason. Moses began to intercede for the people. And the thing that I like about Moses, before we get to verse number 18, Moses began to say, God, we need you to go with us. And God is saying, yeah, no, I'm not going to go, but I'm going to send an angel with you. But can I tell you something today? You need the presence of God with you. No matter wherever you go, you need God's presence. I don't care how many people decide to ride the bus. As long as God is on there, then I'm riding. Right.
So Moses began to talk to God, and God said, I'm going to go with you. But Moses said, no, I need you to go with me and your people. So God says, okay, I'm going to go with you. And so now we get to the text, because Moses is acceptable to what God said. God said, my presence is going to go with you. But Moses decided, I need to see your glory. Is there anybody in the room today that needs to see the glory of God in your life? I wonder today if there's somebody in the room that said, I need to see your glory in my life. First thing we see is Moses' prayer. Because he says in verse 18, Moses says, show me your glory. Moses, the thing that amazes me about Moses was, Moses has been somebody who had experienced God so many times on so many levels. Moses already knew what the glory of God looked like, because he had experienced it at the burning bush. Y'all remember when he was on the backside of the desert and God told him to remove his shoes. You remember Moses was the one doing the 10 plagues. Y'all remember that, don't you? Moses was the one when they parted the Red Sea and made a red carpet of it, when they were able to march over on dry land. Y'all ain't talking to me this morning. He had experienced God ascending on Mount Sinai and the tent of meetings. But yet the most amazing thing about verse 18 is, the more Moses experienced God, the more he wanted from God. Is there anybody in the room today that's not satisfied where you are, but you understand, I need more and more of you?
Feel the need. Pause, make a public service announcement that this is not a typical statement for most of us, because we are content with the little stiff-necked relationship that we have with God. But Moses wanted more of him. In fact, Psalm 73:25, it said, whom have I in heaven but you? And besides you, I desire nothing on earth. Psalm 14:6, he said, I stretch out my hand to you. My soul longs for you as a parched land. And then he says, Selah, which means, what do you think of that? What is the glory of God? Somebody, I wish somebody would just holler at me this morning. What is the glory of God? I'm so glad that you asked. The word glory comes from the Hebrew word kabod. And kabod means abundance. So what Moses is asking God, we So now I'm going to ask the question again. Since you know what glory is, how many this morning need to see the glory of God overflowing in your life? I don't know who I'm talking to, but before you will be able to see the glory of God in your life, get this, you first have to remove and make some room. Jonathan McReynolds from over in Chicago has a song. He has a song called Make Room. And the word says, I find space for what I treasure. I make time for what I want. I choose my priorities. And Jesus, you're my number one. So I will make room for you. I will prepare for two. So you don't feel that you can't live here. Please live in me. Is there anybody in the room today that can sing those words and say, Lord, I need you to live in me? Hey, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, we see the glory of God because the Bible said that it was right after King Solomon finished praying, Deacon Barak, he finished dedicating the temple, that the Bible said that the presence of God came in the place and the priests had to sit down. They could no longer work. They could no longer do anything. I'm looking for the day now that we're back in the gathering. I'm looking for the day that the presence of God comes in this place and shuts us down. You can't sing. You can't pray. You can't preach. The only thing we can do is worship. Worship. So, first thing I saw was Moses' prayer. Second thing I saw is God's response. He says God will always respond where there's a hunger and a thirst of righteousness and a hunger for more of God. And a revival and a restoration of relationship with God. God will always respond because in verse 19, there it is right there. The Lord said, I will make all my goodness pass before your face. And I will proclaim the Lord by name before you. I will be gracious to whom I'll be gracious to. And I will show mercy to whom I will show mercy to. I came to tell somebody that God's glory lies in his goodness. Anybody know how good God has been? Can I just tell you? He woke you up this morning and started you on your way. That's a sign of his goodness right there. Hey, God. So, the Lord says, I will allow you to see. In other words, when the Lord says, I will allow my goodness to pass you, Deacon Smith, and proclaim the Lord by name, what the Lord is saying is, I will allow you to see my character.
All right, God.
And my nature. Because God's name represents his character. The name Yahweh, I am that I am, or I will be whatever I will be. The name Yahweh simply shows his character. God can be whatever you need him to be. Is there anybody in the room today say he was a mother to me when I became motherless? He was a father to me when I became fatherless. He was a doctor when I was in the sick room. He was a lawyer when I was in the courtroom. He was a friend when everybody turned their backs on me. Is there anybody in the room today that can say Christ's character has been on display? Hey, bless your name. It's in verse 20. And he says, he added, you cannot see my face. For no one can see me and live. John 1:18 NIV said, no one has ever seen God but the one and only Son, who himself is God and is in the closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 16. The New English translation says, he alone possesses immortality, which means there's no beginning and no end. And he lies in unapproachable light, whom no human has. has ever seen or is able to see. The Bible says God is a spirit. And therefore, God can't have hands or face or back. I know it says it in the text, but sometimes it seems as though the Bible is a paradox. And a paradox means sometimes it seems as though the Bible is contradicting itself. But I came to say, notice what God does to communicate with us is he uses anthropomorphism. Anthropos meaning man and morphism meaning form. In other words, it's the process of assigning human characteristics to the quality of God, because God wants us to understand him better. Right. And so if he gives himself some hands, then guess what? We'll seek the hand of God. If he gives himself a face, then we'll try to get in the face of God. If he says, I have a back, then you will follow him wherever he leads you. So in other words, God knows exactly what we need in order to believe and trust him. I came this morning because I discovered in the text that the first two things is the prayer, the response, last thing, and I bid you a farewell. The last thing I see is the Lord's protection. The Amplified says in verse 21 that the Lord said, behold, there's a place beside me, and you shall stand up on the rock. Can I tell you something? On this journey that you've been on, it's been the rock that you've been standing on. How do I know? This rock is Jesus. He is the one. That's why Psalm 61 and verse number 2, it said, when my heart is overwhelmed, he leads me to the rock that's higher than I. Is there anybody in the room today? Ain't you glad that when trouble seems to overcome you, there's a rock that's higher than you? Is there anybody glad today that the Lord has made a way for you again and again? That's why the song said in Psalms 90 and verse number 1, a prayer of Moses, the man of God. In other words, this psalm is Moses' prayer. He said, Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. And then he said in verse 2, before the mountain were born, before you gave birth to the earth and the world, from beginning to end, you are God. Is there anybody in the room today that knows that he is God? It has been him that has been keeping you. It's been him that has been protecting you. It's been him that's been providing for you. It's been him that's made a way. It's been him that has poured you over. It's been him that has poured you through. It's been him that has lifted you up. It's been him who can carry you. If there is anybody in the room today that knows that he is
Come on, put your hand.